we were suddenly in a sort of golden place. Is this just
fantasy? We were sort of getting off on how far can we take this.
It's nearly 30 years old, and it's still one of the world's best-loved songs.
It's the biggest single of the century.
I've never heard anything like it.
For the first time ever, this is the full story behind Bohemian Rhapsody. We're going on a journey of discovery back to the studio with the band. The man who put it together is going to take it apart.
I've lost it. Okay, I've lost another Galileo.
We're going to find out how they made that video.
And you get this feedback that trails across.
Mamma mia, let me go.
And we'll be asking some of the greatest literary minds in the country what the song is all about.
And then Beelzebub
does seem to make some sense. Christ.
Mama, I killed a man, you know. Wow. Okay, I'm there. What happened? Nothing happened. We all went off singing nonsense. You know, Scaramouche, can you do the fandango? No.
Because it hurts me now when I hear the song. It hurts.
...1975, history is made as the Americans and Russians meet in space. Saigon falls and Vietnam is finally over. At home, unemployment hits the 1 million mark as Margaret Thatcher becomes the first woman to lead the Tory party. Jaws is a box office smash and Queen released the single that will catapult them to stardom and provide inspiration for a new generation of rockers. Axl Rose performed the song at the Freddie Mercury tribute concert after the singer's death in 1991. He was joined by a host of stars who'd grown up listening to Queen.
1975, I was working in a factory in Sheffield and daydreaming about wanting to be in a band that could produce material of the quality of Bohemian Rhapsody.
I was obsessed with getting all the music that the band put out, you know, looking back on it, it's a huge part of my whole growing up.
Even the band of the moment owe a huge debt to Queen.
Bohemian Rhapsody is the Holy Grail. There's only that, there's nothing else anywhere near it. If you ask anybody, honestly, do you like Bohemian Rhapsody? If they say no, they are lying.
The release of Bohemian Rhapsody defied all logic. It was a song that broke all the rules. For a start, it was 6 minutes long. And it had an opera section. I see a little silhouette of a man. Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the fan? Nothing like it had been heard before, and there's been nothing like it since. But people loved it. It went to number one and stayed there for 9 weeks. But Queen weren't a new band. It had taken them almost 5 years to get there. The year before, they'd had their first success with Seven Seas of Rye. Long lost from the BBC archive, this Top of the Pops performance was videoed by a fan. Freddie's distinctive style was taking shape even then.
Were different to everybody else that was around at the time. They always projected this image of being the big, huge rock stars, even when they hadn't got two albums to rub together.
Queen even turned to women's fashion designer Zandra Rhodes.
I was well known as doing theatrically type women's outfits, and I think it showed quite an extraordinary sense of thought that they came to me.
But it wasn't just the rock star look that Queen were perfecting. Their unique sound was also beginning to take shape. Thanks to their producer, Roy Thomas Baker.
Working with Queen meant, by pure definition, you were working out of the zone. Being told by Freddie and the guys, Queen 2, we've got nothing to lose. Just put anything in there, any idea you come up with, just give it a go.
Queen camped it up even more for their third single, Killer Queen, which went to number 2 in 1974. By now, they should have been enjoying the trappings of a rock star lifestyle, but they were only being paid £200 a week between them.
Freddie was making demands, various things he wanted, and we explained to him at length that money wasn't there yet. It would be there. We could see it coming. If the sales were like they were reported to be, it would flow.
But no matter how much Freddie stamped his feet, there was no money. So Queen turned to Elton John's manager, John Reed.
There was a kind of stalemate between them and the Sheffield brothers. Nothing to do with me. All I was concerned with was how to get it sorted out, how to let them move forward and let everybody walk away with a kind of, without losing face. So that's what I did.
At that time, Freddie lived here on Holland Road in Kensington, London. It was here that he wrote most of Bohemian Rhapsody.
Freddie invited me around to his flat in Holland Road. And I went round there, and when I went in, the thing that struck me first was that Freddie was listening to the Liza Minnelli Cabaret soundtrack, which at that time, I thought, well, this rock group and this music didn't kind of fit. And he showed me the flat, and in the bedroom there was an upright piano with candle arms on it, which was his headboard. And he said that sometimes during the night he would think of something musical and flip it back and play it. He was double jointed and his hands could bend back completely. And I think that's where some of the passages from Bohemian Rhapsody started, playing it backwards.
In the summer of 1975, Queen left London for Rockfield Studios in Monmouth, South Wales. 30 years later, they're back. It's the first time they've visited since they recorded Bohemian Rhapsody.
You know, I think there was a lot of stress. We were very worried about the management situation. We're away from home, we're away from our kids and our families, you know, even though we had young children. It's not ideal. We just signed up with John Reed, who was Elton's manager, and John had said, OK, boys, I'll take care of the business, you just make the best album you've ever made. So there was that feeling, it was like, we have to go in here and kill.
I actually remember driving here, so thinking, I think I'm going the right way, and playing Sheer Heart Attack, thinking, oh, that was the last one we did, oh, God, that's good, isn't it? And it's going to be hard to make a better one than that.
Welcome back to Rockfield after all these years.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
You're like a walk down memory lane for you both.
This is where the seeds for Bohemian Rhapsody were sown. Queen spent 2 weeks here recording backing tracks for what was to become the most expensive record ever made, A Night at the Opera.
Yesterday, my life was in ruin.
It's a poignant trip for Queen. This is where their journey from mediocre domestic success to international stardom really began.
Got a feeling I should be doing all right.
Control room.
Yes, this does actually trigger some memories for me, I've got to say.
A bit plush. I think in our day, I remember there was no acoustic treatment.
This is Bohemian Rhapsody backing track for me. I can distinctly remember being here and seeing you guys going through. It would be, our backing tracks were always either bass, guitar and drums, or bass, piano and drums.
Yeah.
And this one would be Roger, Freddie and John in there, and they're putting down the backing track, and there's lots of spaces in it for the operatic bits.
Well, lots of gaps and Freddie gaps, conducting.
Yeah. Yeah. Dum, 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 dum.
Have a look in the studio.
Yeah.
Here, for the very first time, you can hear Freddie Mercury rehearsing the piano parts for what producer Roy Thomas Baker calls Fred's Thing. These outtakes from the original recording sessions at Rockfield have never been heard before.
Two. One, Roy's announcing it as well. Take one of Mark II version, Mark of, two version. Of Fred's take Thing. One.
That's nice. I tell you, it's slower on there. He just said, look, I've got this very strange thing. You're going to have to be very patient, you know, when we do it, because there'll be a lot of gaps and stuff. But, you know, as soon as really we'd mapped it out, we all sort of understood what was happening. But it was a bit confusing at first, you know. Sort of coming back a bit, yeah. Mm. I think the piano was about that.
I think,
yeah.
It was.
A bit like that.
Yeah, more like, yeah, that than like that. And you were over there, but there was no partition for the drums.
Yeah, that's right.
It was just all in one room.
Yeah. And that was the drum kit.
Yeah, 9 AC30s, of course, but I don't think I would have had the 9 in here, I think.
We were still saving up for the 1, weren't we?
Yeah. I think most likely I would have had 3.
Remember the first time I heard the melody? The main sort of melody. I love the melody.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of our stuff was done, written in the studio, of course, but this is an exception. Really, as Roger says, it was all in Freddie's mind before we started.
Actually, Freddie was a great person to be in a band with, really, because, one, he was such a great rhythmic piano player, and it sort of made the backing tracks very easy to do. They sort of, easy to sort of, we all sort of knitted together and they sort of swung well.
His sort of bony fingers would whack it out, and the backing tracks, if you listen to them now, are immaculate. You know, Freddie and Roger and John are just absolutely together. It's totally live, it's totally real. There's a feel there. As soon as you hit an E-flat chord on here, you think of Freddie, I do anyway.
It's nearly 20 years since Queen played together. This performance at Wembley in 1986 saw them bow out on top. No one could sell tickets faster. But if it hadn't been for the success of Bohemian Rhapsody, they might never have got there. So what's so special about the song that made Queen? To find out, we have to speak to the man who put it all together. Capitol Records, Hollywood, Los Angeles, home to some of the most important recordings in the history of music. Nearly 30 years after he delivered the finished track to EMI, Roy Thomas Baker has come here to take Bohemian Rhapsody apart.
I've lost it. Okay, I've lost another Galileo.
Is another Galileo missing?
This is the original 24-track tape in its original box. It's now so fragile that it has to be baked in an oven before it can be played, or it will disintegrate. And here's Freddie's doodles on the sleeve notes, which he did at the time Bohemian Rhapsody was recorded.
The original mix, when we were doing it manually, it was a case of I was sitting approximately here, controlling the drums, bass, piano, guitars. Then about here was Freddie, and he had control over the vocals. He would be switching vocals on and off and doing it that way. Let me push up the... So this is the piano. This is the piano solo. This was actually done live by Freddie as we were doing the track. So if when you listen to the piano tracks, you can just about hear some of the drums in the background because it was all done in one room. It wasn't done in a separate room. We put covers over the piano to try and deaden down the sound of the other instruments. But the bass, you can hear the bass in the background, you can hear the drums. The drums, then. This is the drums on their own. Okay, now we're... So up a man, Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the bandango? Thunderbolt. Now, John, who was on bass, we spread the bass over three channels. And we had the drums and bass together and piano. This is the solo from Brian. That was also recorded on one track. It wasn't done on multiple tracks. It was just one track.
I wanted to make a little tune that would be a sort of counterpart to the main melody. I didn't want to just play the melody.
It could all have been so different, couldn't it?
So I can remember singing it to Freddie and him going, oh, yeah, that'll be good. And I think certainly my best stuff is born that way. It's much better for me to hear it in my head and then try and play it than sit down with the guitar and sort of let the fingers do it. The fingers tend to be a little predictable unless they're being led by the brain.
We were sort of getting off on the on how far can we take this, you know, let's and how big can we make those harmonies, and let's make a wall of sound that really is a wall, and it starts down there and it goes right up, you know, and so really we were sort of quite interested in seeing how far you could actually go before it became totally ridiculous, or the limits of the technology stopped you.
Okay, this is the little Galileo section, which is between high vocal from Roger and low from Freddie. So this is Roger's track first.
Galileo! Galileo! Galileo Piccolo!
We used to joke about the pliers under the frock, you know. We were lucky. We had a very good chemistry when it came to vocals. And, I mean, Brian could get down quite low. Fred had this incredibly powerful voice through the middle, and I was very good at all the high stuff. So we all sang every part.
Also now you're about to hear the upper section, only the vocals, no backing track at all.
Easy come, easy go, will you let me go?
Bismillah!
No, we will not let you go!
Let him go!
Bismillah!
We will not let you go!
Let him go!
Bismillah!
We will not let you go!
Let me go!
Will not let you go.
Let me go.
Will not let you go.
Let me go.
No, 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 no.
Oh, mamma Mamma mia, mamma mia.
Mamma mia, let me go. Beelzebub has the devil put aside for me, for me, for me.
So you think you can stone me and spit in my eye? So you think you can love me and leave me to die? Oh, baby, can do this to me, baby. Just gotta get out, just gotta get right out of here.
John volunteered not to sing, because I don't think he liked his own vocals. He wasn't going to get an argument from any of us, including the band. So basically it was the three guys, it was Freddie, Brian and Roger who would sing. This is going to be a rare scenario now. We're going to be playing the instrumentation of the opera section without the opera, just purely the track. And the track consists of drums, bass, Freddie on piano, and Roger's overdub of a timpani. There's a few stumbled notes here, which obviously weren't supposed to be heard. Now you might hear them. About Freddie was it was far more organized than he lets on. He'd have little scraps of paper everywhere with little things and little Galileos here, so it was all written down on, you know, just on paper and pencil. It seemed like it was a bit haphazard, but it wasn't. In those times it wasn't easy, it was very, very hard. But we didn't mind because we knew we were setting certain trends that then eventually technology caught up with us, so that was pretty good.
Into their visit to Rockfield, and Brian and Roger can't resist striking up in the studio.
To the living quarters.
Really contemplate what you feel inside.
this is Freddie, I think. And I think this is me. I'm coming to my luxurious apartment. It wasn't just like coming in to make Bohemian Rhapsody, it was like we had to make the album which was gonna, I guess, save us.
But I'd realised Brian's room was this much bigger than mine at the time.
There would have been hell to pay, yeah. This was bigger than Roger's room, yeah.
It really was a job of work. And I remember we just sort of utilised the various rooms about what's basically an old farmyard, you know. This is definitely not on a par with Brian's. One of the key memories I have is we're all sitting up one Saturday night with nothing better to do than watch A Night at the Opera by the Marx Brothers, and we were big Marx Brothers fans.
Oh, I think it's a nice
relatively
room.
Opulent, his was. Kitchen, it's got a door on everything on his. We'd been sort of thinking of things to call the album, etc., etc. And then suddenly there it was, there right in front of us, A Night at the Opera. Education is a matter of fact, so trace your mom.
In a rather sad state, this is the desk, actually, Bohemian Rhapsody, and the rest of A Night at the Opera was recorded on, missing its guts, some of which are still in use in the studio. I still enjoy hearing A Night at the Opera as an album all the way through, because that's the way it was designed. And Bohemian Rhapsody is the jewel in that crown, if you like. It is before the darkness were even born. Give us a kiss.
After 2 weeks, Queen left Rockfield and went to London, where they finished Bohemian Rhapsody and the rest of the album.
You know something special's going on. I've got this little phrase where there are two feelings in your body. You've got a feeling in your head and a feeling in your tummy. The feeling in your head is the one that fools you all the time and teases you, but there's a feeling in the pit of your stomach that you know when something's right or wrong. And this was just something fantastic. Absolutely fantastic, seminal.
When the album was finished, they had to decide on a single. At 6 minutes long, though, Bohemian Rhapsody was considered a huge gamble. Is this the
real life? I remember Brian bought a rough mix of Bohemian Rhapsody round to my flat in London. And he says, this is going to be the new single. And he put it on. And I think, as everybody else he must have played it to, said to him, you ain't got a hope in hell of getting this played on radio, 7 minute long. I'm just a
cool boy. I had an acetate of it, and I played to a couple of people. One of them was Elton John. And I played it to him, and he said, are you fucking mad?
But Queen had a powerful ally.
We invited Kenny Everett along, and he listened to it. And he said, that's wonderful, that's great. They should have a new position. It shouldn't be one, it should be a position above that, like half. And that's where it should be half. And we gave him a copy, and we said, whatever you do, you can't play this. And he said, okay, I won't play it. And winked. And then that following weekend, he played it like 14 times, you know, on his Radio Capital show.
The choice was made, but Queen were about to go on tour, and anyway, they couldn't perform the opera section live, so they had to make a video.
I have to say, the main reason we made it was because we didn't want to go on Top of the Pops. Not because we didn't like the program, but because we didn't feel comfortable standing around and sort of miming in a sort of rather unfamiliar situation. We wanted to make our own vehicle. Plus, we knew we were going to be on tour, and if it was in the charts, we wouldn't be able to go in there anyway.
We were actually signed to a company called Trillium that was an independent outside broadcast unit for sports for ITV. And we suddenly thought, well, why don't we use one of their trucks, get their cameras into Elstree, where we were rehearsing, and we'll film it. You know, we'll put it on this videotape stuff.
The band called in Bruce Gowers, who directed a film of Queen's 1974 concert at London's Rainbow Theatre. He didn't know it at the time, but making the Bohemian Rhapsody video would change his life forever. He's now the director of America's biggest show, American Idol.
There was a call from the band, you know, from Freddie and the group, and we got together and we talked about making a video, which weren't called videos in those days. It was called a pop promo.
We had the idea of bringing Queen 2, the cover of Queen 2, to life, because that was our favourite image of us.
This cover shot was taken by the photographer Mick Rock 18 months before. He'd been inspired by a picture of the actress Marlene Dietrich, which he'd showed to Freddie.
He loved it immediately. He then went and worked on the group, and OK, cool, Marlene Dietrich. You know, Freddie wanted to be Marlene, and he was determined that that should go down.
The whole band was always involved in the discussion and the end result, so it was a cooperative to that extent, but there was but one leader.
Just sit here for a sec, James.
Which one do you want?
Well, try being Freddie for the moment.
So how did they actually achieve the Bohemian Rhapsody look?
There, whoop.
That's good.
How's that?
Yeah. Just go down again. Okay, and up again. That's it.
We tracked down the team who shot the video.
Angle this towards me, please.
Cameraman Barry Dodd and floor manager Jim McCutcheon were sent to Elstree Studios to shoot the video. They had no idea they were about to become part of pop music history.
They'd been in there rehearsing their tour. And what a better place to rehearse a tour than in a film studio, which is the size of a hangar, soundproofed, where the roadies come in, build the stage, build the lighting rig, build the sound rig, but then they wanted to create a video of one of the numbers that they'd done. We'll get the boys in, shall we?
OK, yeah, great.
OK.
They had a very analytical approach to everything. They knew exactly where we were going with what we were doing.
Take your positions, please. Stand by with the smoke.
Here, using the Queen tribute band Gaga, Barry and Jim show us how they did it.
I got to Elstree about 7 or so in the evening, and everything was lit, everything was organised, everything was ready to shoot, and we started shooting at about 7:15.
Are we ready, Barry?
I think so, James, yeah.
OK,
yeah.
Let's have a look at it. Lose the top lights, please. Back lights up. Let's have some smoke, please. And roll the track, please. In 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, music.
Is this the real
Stand by, crossfade.
Is this just fantasy? Caught in a landslide. No escape from reality.
Crossfade, and up you come.
Open your eyes.
And we lit the four faces, and we put the cameras on them. And that was all done beforehand in one corner of this big studio, this big stage. And it was later that we got onto the rock and roll thing, but what a lot of people probably don't know is it was all shot in the same area.
I see a little silhouette of a man.
Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the bandango?
Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me.
Galileo!
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 What we did to get the echo effect on the Magnifico on them, we have a second camera looking at a monitor, and you get feedback, just the same as audio feedback. You get video feedback. And so the vision mixer just opens up the fader as he sings that line, and you get this feedback that trails across.
I'm just a poor boy.
In those days, the technology was good, but a lot of the effects we had to create ourselves. And we used a thing like this. This is similar to the one we use. It's a multifacet lens. And we held this in front of the camera to achieve the multiple images that we see.
Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me.
And in those days, that was special effects, you know. Sort of laughable now.
It was sort of make it up as you go along.
Sparing his life from this monstrosity.
We finished shooting around 10:30. That was the choral element and the rock and roll element. And then we all hightailed down to the pub. I think when we came to edit, there was a rush to get it completed because we were trying to get it aired, I think, the week of shooting on Top of the Pops.
Oh, Mamma
So we cut it in maybe 4 hours, 5 hours, something like that. And as soon as it was done, it was shipped up to the Beep.
Stop tape, please.
I remember distinctly seeing the first rough cut that Bruce brought to show us when we were on tour, sitting around this little telly watching, and we all laughed very heartily, saying, you know, it's really funny, it's really great, it's very slightly kitsch, but it seems to bring the song to life.
The video took less than 4 hours to film and cost just £4,500.
Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy?
It aired on Top of the Pops for the first time in November 75. It was unforgettable, a seminal moment in music history.
I remember the Queen, the Bohemian Rhapsody Queen thing as being like a rarity. You know, something like, oh my God, stop everything. You know, it's a Queen video.
I'm just a poor boy. I need no sympathy.
I remember watching the video and thinking, oh my God, what is this?
Just shocked people and thought, well, look at this, especially those multi-images when the big choir was singing and all that. Nobody had ever done anything like that before. I mean, it was just brilliant.
The video turned Queen and Freddie Mercury into household names, much to the delight of their families.
Well, it was completely a different thing for us to watch, you know, because in those days, they used to perform live on Top of the Pops, but this video came up and everybody were excited about it and the way he sang, especially his costumes.
I remember when Freddie came to visit us for a few days and stayed over, and we thought we'd take him to York for the day. All we saw was a crowd of these school children coming faster and faster towards us, and in the end we had to run the opposite way. And then I realised, my God, he's being recognised by just everybody.
I went to the shops, I was very excited, and they were all around the shops, you know, with Bohemian Rhapsody, Queen. And I got one, and I was so pleased with myself that I'm buying something of my son's first number one record.
Goodbye, everybody.
We were in Southampton playing a concert in our tour, and I remember my mother was there visiting, and I got a phone call in the morning saying you're number one, and I just remember sort of going down to breakfast and going, guess what, Mum, we're number one, you know, and it was great, it was fantastic.
Because it hurts me now when I hear the song, it hurts.
Bohemian Rhapsody went on to sell more than 2 million copies in the UK alone. It sold millions more all over the world. It's highly collectible. Get your hands on one of these, though, and you're sitting on a small fortune. Just like Queen's longest-serving roadie, Peter Hintz.
This is number 195, and yeah, the most collectible record in the world, apparently. Very valuable. What's it worth? I think it's about $2,500 to $3,000. Given to me by my mate Fred. Thank you, Fred. And it'll probably buy me a hearing aid, which I'm sure, after listening to all that bloody noise for all those years, I'm going to need quite soon. So thank you very much.
Some of the music press, however, didn't think Bohemian Rhapsody was worth a single penny. In Melody Maker, they decided the song had all the demented fury of the Balham Amateur Operatic Society performing the Pirates of Penzance.
Lightning, very, very frightening me.
Galileo.
Meanwhile, in America, the song only reached number 9 in the charts. Most people there didn't know what to make of it.
There's a sense with Bohemian Rhapsody, it's almost the quintessential example of the kind of thing that doesn't exactly go over well in America.
It may have captured the hearts of the record-buying public, but it had also captured their imagination. What on earth did it all mean?
Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy? Caught in a landslide? No escape from reality. Open your eyes. Look up to the skies and see I'm just a poor boy. I need no sympathy because I'm easy come, easy go, little high, little low. Any way the wind blows doesn't really matter to me.
So does anybody know what the lyrics are about? We went to Oxford University to ask some of the most brilliant literary minds in the country.
Right from the start, it says, is this the real life? Is this just fantasy? And we, finding out what the fantasy is about and what it might mean is one of the problems in understanding the whole thing.
The more you know about the personality of the person who wrote it, a man, I think, between cultures, between, if you like, selves, presiding over several kinds of selves, several kinds of sexual identities and proclivities and habits, and also, you know, Africa, yes. India, yeah. London.
It's like a story that no matter how many times you tell it to yourself, you think, what on earth is it about, kind of thing.
It's strange, you can listen to it again.
It is like a sweet lady woman because you can try and fathom it, isn't it?
But you'll never understand it.
Yeah, you'll never understand it, and you never need to understand it because the bottom line is you love it.
Mama, just killed a man. Put a gun against his head, pulled my trigger, now he's dead.
Just killed a man? No, you haven't. Put a gun against his head. No, what you've done is taken a nice sounding rhyme from a Beatles song, got up out of bed, dragged a comb across my head, and so on. That's what you're doing. You're inhabiting a world of, actually, in some ways, rather convenient.
I did read somewhere that you were the only person that knew what the song was about and that you would carry that secret to the grave.
I read that as well.
Not true.
I know what the song means. I don't think it's that, you know, that difficult, you know. I think it's fairly self-explanatory. There's just a bit of nonsense in the middle.
Too late. My time has come. Send shivers down my spine. Body's aching all the time. Goodbye, everybody. I've got to go.
Shivers, we've got aching, we've got all sorts of more or less sexual sensations going on, and indeed, the structure of the lyrics trace a kind of sexual rhythm, I think, and it ends up post-coitally, not in some nihilistic position, but simply in a state of careless, indifferent, post-coital exhaustion.
I see a little silhouette of a man. Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the fandango? Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me. Galileo, 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 Figaro, Magnifico. But I'm just a poor boy and nobody loves me.
Scaramouche, Scaramouche. You do the fandango. Brilliant words. I mean, who'd use Scaramouche in a pop song?
Galileo, Renaissance scientist, astronomer. There's no reason for Galileo to be here. Figaro, the marriage of Figaro, perhaps, Mozart, Magnifico. It's there because it sounds like Figaro, and Figaro's there because it sounds like Galileo.
Mama, I killed a man, you know. Wow. Okay, I'm there. What happened? Nothing happened. We all went off singing nonsense. You know, Scaramouche, can you do the fandango? No, you know.
Easy come, easy go. Will you let me go? Bismillah. No, we will not let him go. Let him go. Bismillah, we will not let him go. Let him go. Bismillah, we will not let him go. Let him go. We'll not let you go.
And here you have then a grab bag of cultural illusions that may link together. We can make them link together. But if we make them link together, that's saying more about us than it is about the song.
I think so. It may be just sound. What would Freddie think of us saying all this stuff about his poem? Well, he wouldn't mind, would he?
He would be absolutely delighted that people from Oxford University are talking about
him.
Delighted.
We're presenting the Night of the Opera. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Queen.
As the world pondered the meaning behind Mercury's lyrics, Queen crowned their year with their single and album at number one and a Christmas Eve concert at London's Hammersmith Odeon.
I just love this band. I thought they were terrific.
They were fantastic live. They were amazing live. They could really play and they were dynamic and they had fabulous energy on stage. And so, you know, that fabulous year they had, which culminated in the Whistle Test special at the Hammersmith Odeon, again, you know, this is sort of celebration time.
Now then, we're going to do a nice, tasty little medley for you. Just like the one we did the other day, yes. And we're going to start off with a little segment from a number called Bohemian Rhapsody. Mama!
Bohemian Rhapsody stayed at number one until the end of January the following year. It was to take an extraordinary song from an extraordinary band to knock it off the top.
Mamma mia, here I go again. My, how can I resist you? Mamma mia, does it show again?
We never suspected that we would nudge Queen off the top, but to release Mamma Mia was an obvious thing because it had been such a big hit in other territories. So, and the fact that the words Mamma Mia are included in Bohemian Rhapsody as well, it's just coincidence. When I first heard it, Bohemian Rhapsody on the radio, I thought it was pretty, you know, phenomenal and fantastic. I loved it from the word go, and so did Benny and the girls.
Bohemian Rhapsody went on to top virtually every relevant poll and continues to do so to this day. Queen picked up many other awards too. Perhaps the most impressive was this one, the Brits Special Award for an Outstanding Contribution to British Music in 1990.
Thank you. Good night.
The following year, after Freddie Mercury's death, the single was released again, and guess what?
16 years later, it's number one again, and here it is. This is Queen and Bohemian Rhapsody at number one.
It sold an awful lot around the world, you know, I think as much again as it had done the first time. I suppose I'm not going to tell you I'm surprised. You know, it's a great track. I'm sure it will have another lease of life in another few years.
In America, though, it would take something other than Freddie Mercury's death to send it to the top of the charts. Queen's career there had nosedived ever since they'd released a video which Americans just didn't get.
I remember Freddie saying, I suppose I'll have to fucking die before we begin America again. America had resisted from the days of I Want to Break Free video where we dressed up in drag, which was unforgivable.
I want to break free. I want to break free.
But America's love affair with Queen was eventually rekindled, and Bohemian Rhapsody became a hit again thanks to Hollywood. Remember this?
I think we'll go with a little Bohemian Rhapsody, gentlemen.
Good call.
I think that scene in that movie masculinized that song. You know, I think it made it okay for people. You know, so even though the song was a hit the first time, it wasn't a number one, you know, but it became a much bigger deal, you know, when Wayne and Garth made it okay.
Beelzebub has a devil put aside for me.
I shot this thing probably for, you know, a good 10 hours and did it over and over and over again. And all of the perfect energy came together at the perfect time. It's like we all got struck by lightning.
Christ, love it.
I've been in that car, trust me. With a couple of mates of mine in Sheffield, I have so been there.
That's classic.
And then when the heavy bit kicks in and the heads start going up and down, I nearly wet my pants.
Mike was asking for aspirin because his head was hurting so bad.
It's great hearing your own tracks on the radio, you know, but if it happened, like we're in the Winnebago on tour or something, and it came on the radio, we would all be like sort of headbanging to it, you know, and just sort of enjoying the moment. So I guess Wayne's World were closer to the mark than even they realised.
Hello, everybody.
Even today, Queen's music lives on. More than 1 million people have seen the band's musical, We Will Rock You. And the centerpiece of the show, the one that generations of Queen fans want to hear more than any other, why, do you really need to ask?
Just kills me.
I was 4 years old and it was my mum's favourite song and I thought it was brilliant.
Put a gun against his head.
Pulled my trigger, now he's dead.
But now I've gone and thrown it all away. Mama, ooh.
Well, what can you say? You know, it's unique.
I think it probably was...
We wondered when it was going to finish, didn't we?
Yes.
I was quite young, but I remember the video. It was a very cool video.
Goodbye, everybody. I've got to go. Gotta leave you all behind and
face the truth. What I remember is Wayne's World and the two guys singing in that, and I'll always remember that. It's brilliant.
First time I heard it was on the Live at Wembley video in 86. She was playing it and I walked in and I was like, whoa.
Will you let me go?
Bismillah, no, we will not let you go.
Let him go.
Bismillah, we will not let you go.
Let him go.
Bismillah, we will not let you go.
Let me go.
We'll not let you go.
Let me go.
We'll not let you go.
Never let me go.
No, 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 no.
Oh, mamma mia, mamma mia.
Mamma mia, let me go.
Beelzebub has a devil put aside for me.
I think I've had moments of thinking, oh God, I'll never get away from Bohemian Rhapsody. But when I hear the thing, I still smile and I still feel proud and it doesn't really date.
You can't guess that something will grab the country and eventually a lot of other countries as much as that did. We were surprised at the longevity of the record, yeah? But delighted. Hence our infinite faith in the taste of the public.
And that's it. All you ever wanted to know about Bohemian Rhapsody and more. Save for some choice words from the man who wrote it.
As far as our music is concerned, people should just listen to it and discard and wait. And wait for... And that's what people do, wait for the next one. Bohemian Rhapsody always comes back, but I mean, as far as I'm concerned, all those days are over, that era is over. That type of music is now over, and I don't wish to even think about it or write about it.
No!
To me.
That's it. I don't know any more chords.